To begin with, from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, beginning with verse number 3. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. The main scripture that I read, verse number 4, said there should be no more crying, no more pain, no more death. These are things that we have, as humans, learned to live with every day. Learned to go on every day in spite of what happened to people like us all the time. We've learned that death is a part of life. We've learned that funeral homes are a necessary evil. But there be a day, the Bible says, and we have the authority of the Word of God, that all of these things will pass away. That means there will be no more. The child that's in heaven today is in better condition than we are from that standpoint. Even though our hearts are broken because the death of the child touches everyone here. But considering the fact from the Word of God that the soul and the spirit, which is eternal, when you left the body, immediately entered the presence of God. Well, there is no death. There is no pain. There is no heartache. All is peace and joy and love in eternity forever and forever. Let us pray again. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the Word. We thank you for the strength of the Word of God today. Comfort this family, Lord, again, as only you can. Help them, Lord, to cling to the eternal Word of the living God. Because there be a day when the former things, the things we fought all our lives, Lord, will be no more. We thank you, Lord, for the authority of the Word of God, and letting us know that. In Jesus' name, amen.
So much in love, you're alone in this place, like
family this afternoon, there are really no words in the human language that can comfort you fully today other than the word, and that is the word of God. I've been a minister over 50 years, pastored many churches. I'm pastoring one now. I've looked at the word of God over the years. It is the firm truth. The word is something that we anchor our souls in, because God's word is absolute. There's no doubt about it. And when we think about the things in life that we see that we don't understand, as a minister, I have pastored many people that happen, things happen similar to this, that there were just no words to describe in the natural context what happened. Of course, being human and being inquisitive, we want to know what happened. We want to know why. There are times that we won't have that satisfaction to know what happened, why, all the time. That's where faith comes in, and trusting God. There's a lot of things that goes on in this world that we're not privy to. A lot of things that goes on in this world that we can't see with the natural eye. There's a spiritual world out there that you don't see on television, you don't read on the paper. But the Word of God reveals it. If you don't know the book, you don't know. There's a lot of things you're susceptible to that if you don't know the book, you don't know that you are. But a lot of things I have seen happen. I know one time that something I revealed quickly that happened in my own family that I was surprised. My grandmother was near death, and I went to see her one day, and she said, "Don," she said, "I love you and I love the family, but," she said, "I'm ready to go home." And she said, "I want to see my baby." When she said that, I perked up. I said, "What baby?" I thought my mother was an only child up till I was 20 years old. I said, "What baby?" She said, "Well," she said, "I had a child, a male child that was born, that was stillborn." And she reached into an old Bible and pulled out a picture of her and my grandfather and the baby in a bassinet, fully dressed, and a picture of it. I've never seen that picture before in my life, and I was 22 years old at her. And she said, "I enjoy life and I enjoy my family. I love every one of you, but there's something reaching from beyond." That she said, "I'm sick and I'm old and I'm tired." And she said, "I want to go see the baby." And I began to cry. I cry pretty easily and things like that. And I said, "Well," I said, "you mean to tell me that I've got an uncle in heaven that I've never seen? Male child." She said, "You've got an uncle in heaven that you've never seen." I said, "Well, go on, and that'd be fine." And I said, "We'll follow on." And I said, "I look forward to seeing my uncle, another family member in the presence of the Lord." That may sound strange, but I didn't know anything about that until that day she showed me that picture. But you know, I've got more in heaven now than I have here. A couple of months, I'll be 72 years old, lived a long time, and I appreciate life and what the Lord has given to me. But there's sometimes that I think about going home where there's no trouble, there's no problems, there's no cancer, there's no strokes, things like that. That are common everyday people. I'm, quite frankly, I'm tired of, because I've had some of that myself, and then I've pastored many people that have had. But going back to this situation, there are things in this life that we will not understand, never understand. As a pastor, I've talked to people that had tragedy in their lives, good people that came to church and served the Lord and did the best they knew how to do, good, hardworking people that had unspeakable things that happened to them, car wrecks and killed children and things like that. And I say there's nothing that I can say. I pray with you and give you the confidence and strength of knowing that one day, in the presence of God, we'll see them again, and we will. But I said, as far as me being able to say anything that could really comfort you at the moment, there's nothing. That sometimes that mere words are inadequate. That is from the natural standpoint, but the Word of God is always adequate. I said, we hold on to the truths of God. Faith is like a big shield. We hold it up. That that when all the tragedies of life come our way, we hold that shield of faith up and we say we believe. We hold on to God. We don't understand. There's a lot of times that we don't understand, but we believe. To me, that is the strength of faith and strength of the Word of God. I remember on one occasion reading about the great man Job in the Old Testament. I've read this Bible through so many different times, so many great thoughts that I found in there, but something I think that would fit today, just briefly taken from the book of Job, chapter 1 and verse 21. And Job said, and he said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return hither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Now, to a lot of people, that may not mean anything. But to a Christian that trusts God and realize that life is out of control, if there's anything that could have been done to save this child, it would have been done. But there are things that are out of our control. But God has an answer. God has a reason. And we hold on to the faith, trusting Him that one day, in the presence of the Lord in heaven, we'll see it again and we'll know more than we do now. We have quite heard that through the book, Job was a man that was wealthy in his day and time. He was a good man. He was a righteous man. If you've ever read the book, it's a wonderful book to read. But one day, there was a conversation that went on between Satan and God. The Bible said that Satan appeared in the presence of the Lord. And the Lord said, have you considered my servant Job? And the devil says, Satan says, yes, but said, you've got a hedge built around him. Job was a praying man. Job was a man that offered sacrifices for his children. He was a godly father. And the devil said, you've got a hedge built around him. He said, you remove that hedge and let me get to him. He said, he'll curse you to your face. The Bible said the Lord removed the hedge. In just a matter of hours, in a day or day and a half, I've studied it out, and he lost 10 children. He had 10 children. He had 7 boys and 3 girls. And they're all in the house one day having a meal, and the house fell on them, killed them all at one time. His servants were killed in the field taking care of the cattle and all. There were marauding bands that came and stole the cattle and killed the servants. One by one, the servants that came and told him, said, your children are gone. Your cattle's gone. In those days, they didn't have money. They had livestock that they bought and sold and traded those livestock. He lost the children. Can you imagine? 10 children in one day. Lost all the cattle. Lost all of his servants, lost everything. And this is like 1, 2, 3, 4 coming right at the other. And finally, the Bible said that the enemy, the devil, Satan, afflicted his body with sore wounds. I've had some of those things. Sores on his body. He took a piece of an old clay pot and scraped himself, scraped the corruption out of it. He sat down in what was called sackcloth and ashes, which was a sign of severe mourning. And then last but not least, the devil always has the last hammer blow that he thinks that will seal the deal. His wife, who should have been supportive, even though she lost the children, she lost all of the substance, she was suffering from the loss as much as him. Instead of coming up to Job and putting her hand on him and saying something comforting, she said, Job, why don't you just curse God and die? What a thing. I told my wife, I said, whatever happens to me, don't ever say that. We have a great relationship. We've been married 52 years. It's coming the 20th day of September, if we last that long. But anyway, for a man's wife to come to him and say, why don't you just curse God and die? He's already hurting for the loss of the children, hurting for the loss of his cattle, the loss of his servants. He's lost everything. And his body is covered with sore boils. He's sitting in ashes. I've cleaned out a fireplace many times, got the old dirty ashes. I wouldn't sit in them for nothing. But it was a sign of mourning when they sat in ashes. Many times I wore sackcloth, like old potato sacks. My grandfather had a grocery store. I'd take the potatoes out of the sack, no rough burlap bags. I'd rather have this nice suit I got on today. But anyway, he sat in the ashes. He was in total misery. But he said, the Lord hath given, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. A man of a different spirit, and when you've got to consider one thing that's primary, all of this happened to him, and he did not know why. Lost 10 children one time. Lost his service, his cattle, everything that he had in the way of real estate, livestock. He was broke. Not only on top of that, his body was affected. He was sick. Didn't have penicillin like we have today, or doctors you can go to and run an MRI and all of that. He was in bad shape. But yet in his spirit, he didn't know what was happening or what had happened to him, but yet he said, the Lord gave, and the Lord had taken away. And the last statement, blessed be the name of the Lord. He knew there again that God was not letting all that happen to him because of anything he had done. Even though he had three so-called friends that came and stayed with him for a few days and tried to get him to confess to something he didn't do. They said, sure to Job. You know, there's a lot of people out there now that think that when people have trouble like this, that's just bad luck. I don't believe in luck. I believe in the providence of God. And I believe there's things that happen in this world that we don't understand and we'll never understand. There's no use worrying our minds. Remember this, couple. No use worrying our mind and spirit. When we've done all we know to do, that's all we can do. We trust God. We may not understand, but we hold his hand and we trust that there's a reason for these things and how they came that way. See, Job didn't know that there was a meeting between the Satan and the Lord, and that they didn't know he didn't know that he was being discussed. He didn't know that it was the enemy, the devil. But the Bible says that in the New Testament that the thief cometh but to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. So let me say today, really, don't try to figure out everything that happens in your life. Because you wind up a nervous wreck. That's right. Because there are some things that you'll never know. Some things that's happened to me in my life as a minister. We had a bad wreck one time and put my wife and myself, and I had two sons, put one of them in the hospital in Athens. And I was laying in the bed that night after the wreck, and thank the Lord I lived through it. And one of my church members came and said, preacher said, why did this happen to you? I says, why not? I said, I'm serving the Lord. I said, the devil's my enemy. I said, he would kill me if he could. He would. He would kill me if he could. But I said, thank the Lord I survived it, and here I am. So I didn't understand, but there again, being a minister today, the Lord's not going to, there again, protect me above anybody else. I go through life just like you do. What comes my way, I take it and go on with it. But there's one thing, I'm like Job. I'm looking for a better day and a better kingdom. Looking for a better day when I see my uncle that I've never seen before. See my grandmother and all those that's going on. And the things that come my way in this life, I say, Lord, I don't understand. But I'm going to say, the Lord give it. The Lord's taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And the things that I don't understand in this life, I've got them filed away in my mind. Things that I wonder about even now. Why did this come up? Well, why did this happen? Well, why not? Life is full of mispredictions. It's full of trouble. And you're going to have trouble. There's going to be good times. There's going to be bad times. And this is a sad, bad time to serve. Is there anything we could have done that would have prevented that? That blessed child. But I'll say this in closing, the child's in a better place. We don't know why the Lord took there again that be taken there after 30 days. But you had the 30 days. My grandmother, her child died, it died in me. She didn't get to see it smile or whatever. So I just seem to think that there's sometimes we have greater blessings when we don't realize it. But I say to the family today that there be a better day and better time in the kingdom of God. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, today for the word. We thank you for the strength of faith, the Lord, that reaches past these circumstances and these situations and causes us to realize there be a better day in the kingdom, in the eternal kingdom of God. Strengthen this family, Lord, as only you can in this very sad, sad time and occasion. Be their strength in days to come. In Jesus' name we pray and ask these favors humbly. Amen and amen.
One day I turned around, leaves are falling.